We are having the legendary Victor Momo. You know, he needs no introduction for many of us, but for those who will be watching the video, then I need to do some introduction. So Victor Momo is a petroleum engineer, and he's worked as IT auditor, he's worked as an IT support analyst, he's worked as a process engineer. But more importantly, he's the pillar behind the Nigeria Excel user community. He's Excel personified. You know, there's some all the good adjectives you throw, and they never can come up to an exaggeration when you put Excel and Victor in the same sentence. So let me just wrap it with that. I know the session is going to be a lot, so I don't want to spend so much time on introduction. I'm just going to bring him up stage. And so, Victor, over to you.
Okay. So I guess you can still hear me, right?
Yes.
Okay. First of all, let me just share my screen. So once I have that up, then we can go ahead and get started. Okay. All right. So can you see my screen, Michael?
Yes.
Very. Okay, fine. All right. So good. Yeah. So good afternoon, everybody, and morning to some. I don't know if I should say good evening to some or good night. So it's really a pleasure to be here. And Michael, first of all, thank you again for, you know, this opportunity. I don't take it for granted. So it's a pleasure to be here. And I'm just going to continue on what, you know, we started off on the 14th. Yeah, that was 2 weeks ago. So what we talked about then is the power of a single function. Maybe I'll just put up, you know, this slide first of all. You know, what I've decided to do here is to recap two examples from the first session. Hopefully I can do that in record time. And then I go into what I have for today. I know when we put up the link for this session, most people were like, they wanted to review the first one, which I felt really was good, you know, so a good foundation for this. But I thought it's maybe wise to just give a little overview, then treat just like two examples quickly to just pass across two major, you know, concepts as regards the function I will be talking about, or I started talking about, and then I can go into what I have for today. Because the examples for today, of course, are naturally more complex than what I treated before, and I think that's expected, right? You start from simple and you progress that way. Okay, so just to recap, the function I've decided to talk about here, for those who are in the first session, you know that is the sum product function, right? So, like I said, it's a very versatile function and very powerful. For those of us who were in the session last week, you remember that we had Alan Murray. He did mention, yes, that of course in Office 365, you know, with the dynamic arrays, some products behave a little differently. But if you are using the pre-Office 365, Excel 20, 10, 13, 16, 19, you know, some product is a function that you really, really need to know. It's very important because it can handle arrays, and that's one of the problems that a lot of functions in Excel have, you know, handling of arrays. But some product was designed for that purpose. So for that reason, you know, it's a function of choice. So what is it really? When you think about it, it's two words, it's sum and product. So what you are doing essentially is you are finding the sum of products. That's what it's supposed to do, and that's what it does. So what I mean here is that I'm going to go into Excel and show you, of course, if you have A1, B1, A2, B2, A3, B3. So if you multiply A1 by B1, A2 by B2, A3 by B3, and add everything together, what you've done there is that you first of all done products by multiplying those two cells, and then you then get a sum of, you know, the results. That's kind of how the sum product works. So I want to make this a little clearer to you using two examples. And one example would be sum product without conditions. The second will be sum product with conditions. So these are like the foundation for the sum product. It can get really complex, but at least let's have a basic understanding. Then once we get that, we can then build on it. So let me jump out of PowerPoint and go back into sum product here. So like it's written here, multiplies corresponding components in given arrays and returns the sum of those products. Sounds like English, but an example will make it very clear. So this is an example I treated 2 weeks ago, and I'm just going to take it again. So this is Victor's shopping list. So Victor is going for shopping, and he needs to get a few of these items, right? Or these items. These are the unit cost of the items, and these are the quantities. So now the question is, I think I still have the formula in here, but I'll take it out. Yeah, because I saved the workbook just as it was at the end of the session. So what we want to do here is I want to send somebody to go get all these items for me. And I want to know how much does the person need, you know, to deliver on this task to get me back the products. We all know what to do. So I'm going to do it the simple way, then I'll do it with some products. So now, if I want to get the cost per item, in this case, what I really want to know is how much I need to go to the market with. So I'm not really interested with the breakdown of biscuits, sweets, chocolates. No, I don't really need to know how much each item costs. All I need to know is that I need to give this person 10,000 and, you know, he's going to get everything I need. So how do I get the cost, you know, per item? Here, for biscuits, it means I'm just going to do what? The quantity times the cost. You can do it in the reverse, cost times quantity. Like I said last week or 2 weeks ago, it's a commutative operation. So A times B equals to B times A. It doesn't really matter. Okay? So this is the amount for what? Biscuits. Okay? Everybody can follow that, right? So now when you then add up the other items, this is the cost for each of those items. You can then come to the bottom and do a sum. To do an auto sum in Excel, you do Alt equals, right? Most of us should know that. So Alt equals, then you press Control Enter. Control Enter because I don't want to move to the next cell. I want the active cell to remain where it is. So I have 10,300. Now let's review what we just did. What we did here was what? First of all, how did we get 5,000? We did what? Cost multiplied by quantity. Unit cost and quantity. How did we get 1,000 here? We did cost multiplied by quantity. How did we get 4,000? Cost multiplied by quantity. So what did we do? We first did products, that's multiplying cost by quantity. And when we were done doing all the products, what did we now do? We now did a sum of those products. Do you see where the function name comes in now? It's a sum of products. So it means that when you have any scenario that looks like this, you can use the sum product function. You don't need to have five cells, you know, to get the result that I can get in one. So what I'm going to do now is just to do the sum product function. So I'm going to do equals to sum product. Sum product needs essentially just one array. In this case, just think of an array as a range. That's what I want to say to simplify it. So it's really just a range of cells. The important thing you need to know here is that it needs just one. Why? Because when you look at the arguments here, you notice that there's a square bracket around array 2, a square bracket around array 3. Anytime you look at a function and you look at the arguments and they are square brackets, it means that those arguments are optional, meaning that the function can work without those arguments. So the only thing it needs here is array 1, but typically you always have two arrays, most times in most cases that we want to solve, okay? So what I just need to do for some product now is just to give it the two arrays. What's the first thing? I have cost, I put the entire cost. I put a comma, and I put the entire quantity. Once you give some product these two ranges, it knows that it should multiply individual elements by themselves. Close the brackets, Control Enter. Do you see? We have 10,300. Same answer without going through those intermediate steps. So that's how interesting some product is. It can perform these operations without the use of helper cells or helper columns. Okay? So one thing you need to note at this point is this. Whenever you are doing a sum product, the dimensions of the array or the ranges must be the same. What do I mean? Look at cost here. You had four cells. Look at quantity here. You had four cells in terms of rows, right? If you change this from 4 to 3, for example, automatically you're going to have an error. Why? Because at the end of the day, the question is this. Who am I multiplying my 10 here by? Do you understand? So the dimensions must be consistent. So that's one important thing to note, right? The dimensions must be consistent. Dimensions are not consistent, you're going to come up with an error. Okay, so that's the first example I just wanted to review, just, you know, to get people, you know, along based on what we did 2 weeks ago. So I'm going to do one more example. And after that, I will then go into, you know, some more examples, which is kind of like today's, you know, today's examples. Okay, I'm looking at the time. 10 minutes, not too bad. So now this is another question here, a problem I also solved 2 weeks ago. So what we have here, and I've tried to use very simplistic examples, not discipline-specific examples, that we can all relate to. So in this one here, just think about it this way. You're a teacher and you're a math teacher. So these are the list of students in your class. These are their year of births, and you know, these are their scores in, you know, the mathematics exam. And what you're just trying to do is you just want to find out two things. One, how many students, you can just read it over here. Maybe I just reduce the zoom a little first. So how many students were born after 93 and had a score greater than 92? Okay, so there are two things in one. I want to know how many students were born after 1993 and, you know, scored greater than 92 in maths. That's one thing. I also want to know the sum of those scores. So if there are three students, for example, and they score 50, 80, 70, I need to add that up together and give me 200 and say I have three students who meet that criteria and the total score is 200. This is something I said 2 weeks ago and I repeat it again, that one of the powerful things about sum products is the fact that sum products can function as six other functions and even more. Whenever you want to do anything that has to do with conditions in Excel, you always think of the if function. You know, if it's a conditional statement. So when you say if this, then this, else this. So when you say, oh, I want to check how many people, if they are this, if they are that, you think of if. Whenever you want to count based on criteria in Excel, you know, you use count if and count ifs. Count if for one condition, count ifs for multiple, right? You have sum if and sum ifs if you want to sum based on conditions. You have average if and average ifs if you want to take averages based on conditions. But I'm telling you now that sum products can replace those six functions. I'm not trying to say here that those functions are not powerful in themselves, but this is just to also market the versatility, if you may, of, you know, the sum product function, right? So now what we are doing in this case is more like a count ifs and sum ifs, because we are counting based on conditions, we are summing based on conditions. So naturally I would use count ifs and sum ifs, but here I'm going to use sum product. So let me show you how, you know, this one works. So don't lose sight of what we are trying to do. We have a small list here, and we just want to know how many students, you know, were born after 93 and scored greater than 92. So let me x-ray for you what sum product we do, but let me do it outside here. What it would do is it would come here and check the year of birth. Is it greater than 93? This is just a test, right? I'm testing, is the year of birth greater than 93? This should return for me either a true or a false, right? Okay, so it tells me it's true. And that's correct, because 94 is after 93, okay? So you can take this down. So you can see there are places where we have false. So that's where the condition isn't satisfied. What's the second condition? The second condition is that the score is greater than 92. The score now. So I come to the score and test if it's greater than 92. Then I take it down. Double click. So now, what you realize is that you have true, false all around. If you want to know those who were born after 93 and who scored greater than 92, it means that they must have true in both columns. Am I correct? I'll answer for myself. Yes, I am. So essentially what you're looking for is anywhere that you have true and true. So you multiply both. That's like saying this and this. Okay. So you would get ones and zeros. Ones are those who satisfy both conditions, while zeros are those that either satisfy none of the conditions or one of them. So this is what sum product is going to do internally. It's going to test based on these conditions. And at the end of the day, it's just going to add up how many ones it has. And it says, oh, there are two students that meet the criteria. That's really what sum product is doing. Okay, I just decided to x-ray it for you so that when I get into sum product, you kind of understand. So now let's try and do this with sum product using the same logic. Okay, so just do sum product. I guess we should be more familiar with it now. The first thing is to put the first condition, which is what? That the year of birth is greater than 93. So just take all the years, select the first one, control shift down, do greater than what? 93. That's the first condition. Then put a comma, go to the second condition. What's the second condition? The second condition is that the score, select the first one, control shift down, is greater than what? 92. You close the bracket. That's all you're supposed to do. This is one thing I want everybody to learn how to do. Evaluate portions of your function. Whenever I'm building a very big function in Excel, what I do is I evaluate it as I go, because you see some very huge functions, but it always starts from a small piece. Always check that every section of your function is working the way you want. So what I will do first of all is I will highlight the section I want to evaluate. Just watch what I'm doing here. So I highlight from C, or let me go from right to left, okay? And then I press F9, but on my own keyboard, I typically have to press function. So do you see what's happened? Internally, you can see what's there, true, false, do you see this is exactly what we have here? If you read what I have down here and what I have in my formula, it's the same. So that's what it has internally, but it doesn't show you that, except you evaluate. You press Control Z to come out of it. You can evaluate the second portion, you get the same thing. So this is supposed to be the end. Once you press enter at this point, you're supposed to have an answer. But what will happen is that you're going to get zero as your answer, which is wrong, but which at the same time is right. I've explained that. The answer is not zero because we know that we have at least one student that meets the criteria. So why am I getting zero? This takes me to the second thing I want everybody to know and always remember. The first thing I said was about the dimensions of the arrays, that whenever you want to multiply arrays, they must be of the same size, essentially, right? But there's a caveat to that statement. We'll get to that further down. The second one is that some products does not accept non-numerics. So let me just show you that clearly so that you would see it. For those that were around, they're like fantasy league. Wow, this guy plays fantasy football. Yeah, I do. I had to find something else aside Excel. Something boring. So go to some products. Look at the remarks. So when you go to the remarks, you would see here clearly. Some product treats non-numeric array entries as if they were zeros. So what this means is that whenever you have as your result anything that is either, you know, not a number, 1, 2, 0 or whatever, some product is going to treat it as what? As zeros. So how is that information important? Here, because when you evaluate these expressions, you don't get numbers. You get true, false, true, false. As far as Excel is concerned, those are not numbers. Those are Booleans, right? But if you perform a mathematical operation on a Boolean, you can convert it to a number. Let me show you a classic example here. Just type true in this cell and just come here and say equals to 0 plus true. You see what happens? Once you say 0 plus true, it becomes 1. So once you perform any mathematical operation on, you know, a Boolean, it becomes a number. You can do 1 times and it becomes a number. So that's the problem with the sum product here. Because you are getting Booleans, sum product doesn't work. So what you have to do is just find a way to convert, you know, these Booleans into true and false. If you go through the PowerPoint, which I will make available to everybody, I have shared, you know, a couple of ways you can do that. Okay, so there are many ways to doing that, but I'm just going to take a simple one. I can take 0 plus, and let me just explain that briefly. Whenever you add 0 to a number, the number still remains the same numerically. So it means that if I say 0 plus Victor, it should still be Victor because I'm adding nothing to it. So that's a good one to just use. Or you can say 1 times, because anything multiplied by 1 still remains the same. So what I'm going to do here is, for all these arrays that I have, rather than having them the way I've written them, I will make sure that I enclose that entire criteria with and put a 0 plus in front of it. So I'm going to do 0 plus the whole criteria. Just watch it. I'm doing it one after the other. So this is criteria 1 now, right here. But rather than having that criteria alone, I've added 0 to it. I'm only adding 0 so that 0 can help me convert true and false to numbers so that some product can work. Let me now highlight it. When you highlight the portion with the 0, highlight the portion with the 0 now. Everybody, let's press F9 here. Do you see what has happened? You are now seeing 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0 rather than true, false, true, false, true, false. That's all the 0 plus is doing for you. So it's just helping you to convert Booleans into what? Numbers. Okay, so just do the same thing here. Do 0 plus and then close the whole criteria in brackets. You need one more bracket. Like I always say, the last bracket is black, at least when your Excel uses this white theme. So once you are done with this, you can now press your enter. And you can see that we now have an answer of what? 2, which is the right answer. So I just did this example to highlight 2 important things. That first of all, don't forget about dimensions. You know, the row height or the column width should be the same. You know, then secondly, some products doesn't like what's it called? Sorry, I think there's someone talking at the background. So some product doesn't like what's it called? Non-numbers. Anything that isn't numbers, some product treats it as zeros. So all I've done in this is just to find a tricky way to convert true and false into zeros and ones. Okay, so with this, I know that there are 2 students, you know, in my class that were born after 1993 and scored greater than 92. It's very simple. Just put the 2 criteria there. The first one is that what? The year of birth is greater than 93. That's the first. The next one is that what? The math score is greater than 92. That's all, really. The only reason for the 0 plus, if you watch this carefully here, is just to convert the true and false into ones and zeros. I hope this is, you know, really clear to everybody. So if you now want to get the total score of those 2 students, after getting these 0101s, what you can do is just to include the scores as the last, you know, argument of your array, so that the 0 and 1s will then multiply the scores. Anyone that is 0, meaning that didn't meet the criteria, by the time 0 multiplies the score, it's still going to be 0, so it's not going to affect your results in any way. So at the end of this, after putting, I'm doing two things here. The first thing I did was a count to know how many, which is what I've done. Now I want to do a sum, which is the scores. You know, I can now include the scores as my third argument. So what the first two arguments have done for me is to address these conditions. Born after 93 and greater than 92. Then the next thing I'm putting here is just so that I can include the scores in there. Okay, now you ask me, do I need to put my 0+ for the scores? The answer is no. Why? Because these are already numbers. So you don't need to convert numbers to numbers. So with this, you should be fine, and you can just press Control Enter. And it tells you that, okay, 189. So if you have those two numbers in your head, it means that we have two students that meet this criteria, and the total score of those two students is 189. So if you doubt that, let's just do a filter on the data to confirm that. So let's filter on the data for the year. Just do your year should be what? Greater than. Most of us know how to filter, right? So I shouldn't teach this. And then your score is what? Greater than 92. I'm just following the question and seeing if my answer makes sense. Huh? So now, what do you have? After doing the filter, you can see that we have two students, Michael and me. And when you add their two scores together, 94+95 gives you 189. You can see that what at the bottom here. So that's using sum product to do a conditional, you know, summation, so to say, or I will call it conditional aggregation. So you can use it to do count if. What we've done now is to do count ifs, because we have multiple conditions, and you can also use it for sum ifs, which is what we just did, to also sum, you know, the scores that meet the criteria. I think I'm getting some feedback. Michael, if you can help out.
Apologies for that. I've muted.
No, it's fine. It's expected. In fact, if you join a meeting and that doesn't happen, you should ask yourself if you are still in the right place. You know, at some point, I was wondering, like, am I talking to myself? Okay, so this is the second example that I wanted to treat. Let me just add one more thing. Let me solve this one again in one other way, just to explain the last concept. Then I go into the examples for today. For those of you who have seen this before, I apologize, you know, but I feel it's good to do a decent recap and then get into what we need to do. At least let's see if we can carry as many people as along as possible, some Pareto type thing, right? Maybe some 80 people or 80%. Okay, so now what I want to do is I want to write the sum product in a different way. The way we all know sum products, when you look at it here, do you see the way sum product is written? It says array 1, comma, array 2, comma, array 3. So it means you need to separate with a comma. But what you can do is this. At the end of the day, if you think about it, when it does these multiplications, okay, I've said the answer already. When it performs this operation, sum product is doing a multiplication. It's taking what you have in column 1, multiplying by what you have in column 2, takes the next element, multiplies, takes the next element and multiplies. So what we do most times to avoid all these 0+1 times and all those manipulation is to, instead of using a comma to separate, is to use a multiplication sign. When you use a multiplication sign, you are already doing what sum product would be forced to do. So you are helping it. So let me repeat this just using a multiplication sign. So just watch me. I will put every condition in its own bracket. So let's take the question one after the other again. We want to know the number of students that were born after 93 and scored greater than 92. So let's start with the first thing. The first thing is that what the year of birth, select everything, that's it, is greater than what, 93. That's the first one. Close that bracket. Rather than putting a comma, do a times asterisk. So now we want to multiply it by the second condition, which is really what sum product does. The second condition is that what? The mass score is what? Greater than 92. That's the next one. Then let's multiply by the third condition in this case, because I want to get a sum just to multiply it by the scores themselves. Okay? So when you do this, you don't need the 1+ or 1 times 0+, you don't need all those manipulations to convert true and false to what? To numbers. You don't need it. This will take care of it. And so this is how I typically write my sum product. Okay, so press Control Enter and you see we get the same answer. So this is, I think these two examples kind of summarize everything I did in the last class, right? So key things to note, and I just want to emphasize that. So key things to note. First of all, I mentioned this already. Some product treats non-numeric entries as zeros. This is very important. Huh? So whenever you are writing a sum product and it's going to give you true, false, true, false, find a way to convert it into numbers by using any of these approaches. The slides will be made available. The workbook will be made available. You can always practice. And like I always say, I don't expect you to get everything I say in this session. I mean, even the geniuses will struggle to do that. But if you do, you know, all well and good. You can always watch it again and practice and you'll be fine. Okay, so that's one thing to know. Then if you go here too, okay, yes, this is the important one. Let me just zoom in a little. It says the array arguments must have the same dimensions. If they do not, sum product returns an hash value error. Okay, so which is why I said if you are taking four rows here, you should be taking four rows here. Okay, because you are multiplying individual elements. The first times the first here, the second times the second. So if you don't have the same dimension, then somebody will be left without anybody to multiply with or multiply by. So that's the whole idea. So those are the key things you need to have in mind when approaching the sum product, you know, function. I decided to go into, you know, this much detail so that everybody really understands it rather. You know, I'm an advocate of understanding. I'm always like, you know, we need to understand what's going on. If you understand the fundamentals, you can always, you know, manipulate it anyhow to get what you want. Okay, so let me go into today's example. So I guess everybody should be with me right now. Should I say if you are not with me, say no. No, don't say no. You are all with me. So it's the eyes have it. Okay, so now let's go into today's examples. And Victor. I'm going to treat. Yes, sir.
So someone's hand is up, so I'm thinking maybe this might be a good chance to a good
to take
question. Yeah,
excellent, excellent. Yeah, so let's take the question. Yeah,
okay,
comments.
So, yeah, okay. Oga Francis. Yes.
Yeah, Mr. Victor.
Yes, sir.
I'm in the last your example. Let's go back to the sheet. The example on that sheet that we are working on.
Okay. All right, fine. Yes,
yeah, you know, it's just I just want to clarify something so that it's not too much. You know, when you said the year of birth is greater than 93, can you also select this 93 instead of entering the full date of birth? You know, because I'm still working with the data in the column.
Yeah, you said can I select, take that again, sorry.
Yes, like you said, the year of birth now is greater than,
yes,
93. I just select this 93 instead of typing.
Okay, this 93 here, right? Oh, yes, yes,
yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Okay. In fact, typically, no, it's a good question, and thank you for that question. Excellent question. Typically, I would not even hard code it in this way, the way I've done it. What I would do is I would have here, for example, and say, yeah, you know, and say 1993. Why? So that I can easily come here and just change this, and the formula will update. You know, the teacher could come tomorrow and say, no, I'm not interested in, you know, 1993, for example. I'm interested in 94.
Yeah, yeah,
if I have a lot of formulas that have that 93 hard-coded, then I'm in a lot of trouble, right? I have to start changing it in every formula. So what I would normally do, standard practice, is I would have it in a cell like this. So rather than do, you know, greater than 93 here, I'll be pointing to that cell E1. Do you understand? That's what I would do. So it's a good question, yeah. But I might not be too keen on pointing to one in the data set. Reason why is that somebody could come and maybe insert a row or do something funny and 93 is no more where it's supposed to be, you know, something like that. Or maybe I'm just being paranoid anyway. So, but this is what I would do. I would typically have it as a different cell that I can easily just manipulate. But for the purpose of this example, I just wanted to hard code so everybody sees. Because by the time I start saying, oh, greater than E1, somebody's like, which one is E1 again? So let them see the 93 there and know what I'm doing. But thank you for that question. At least it allowed me to explain, you know, something else. So thank you very much.
You. Yeah. Thank you.
All right. Okay, so Michael, any other question?
Let me just check the chat side.
Okay.
No questions. So
no questions. Okay, so the assumption is that everybody's with me. Okay, so good. So now let's go into you know, some more examples. And yeah, see if I even come again next week, I probably won't still finish some products. So but let's we just do a few more examples. So I want to do one more here, an interesting one. This is where we use a wild card. for those of us that are kind of familiar with Excel, we know when we talk about wildcards in Excel, I'm talking about essentially, some people will say two characters but three characters. Asterisk, that's one. So asterisk, you know what that is, right? Okay. The other one is what? The question mark. And the third one is, some people will say it's the tilde, but that one is argument. It's arguable, rather. Okay. But essentially, these two, asterisk and question mark. Okay. So there are some times that you want to find, you know, maybe rows that meet a certain criteria, but you really don't know the exact, you know, word, but you know that, oh, it must contain this. For example, you know, you just want to find everybody whose name starts with an M. If you're looking for everybody whose name starts with an M, you really don't know. There are so many names that start with, you know, an M, right? Maybe Michael, Moses, Majid, you know. So how do you now tell Excel, help me find Michael, Moses, Majid? It means you now have to have a list of all the possible names that start with M. You don't know. So in a place like Excel and in other programming languages, you can do something like M asterisk. What this means to Excel is find any name or text that starts with M and has any other number of characters to the end. This is not a wildcard session. I'm getting too excited. So let me just restrain myself. Okay, so, but what I want to point out here is that when you are not looking for a text specifically as it is written, you typically want to use a wildcard. But this is one of the drawbacks of some products. Some products does not accept wildcards. I'll take that again. Some products does not accept wildcards. And if you check the documentation, you probably see that it doesn't accept wildcards. So you have to find a way to trick it to make it work. But this is where, like, the count ifs easily work. You can easily do that. So let me explain this example and show you what it is I'm going to do. So this is just an example, a list of MVPs. So, of course, Michael is at the top of that list, right? So Michael, you know, and then their locations, region. Don't read too much into this. I was trying to make it make sense, but at the same time, I was like, don't make it make too much sense. Just explain what you want to do. You know, then they were given a mandate to go and get just one product from the store, you know, and you can get as many quantities as you want. So this is just what that is, right? So I think the data is simple enough for all of us to understand. So the name, location, the region, what product the person bought, the unit price, and how many. So Michael bought, you know, two toothbrushes. I don't know why, you know, maybe for he and Madam then, you know, at a price of $5. Well, that's an expensive toothbrush. Oh, Kunle Ojo, is that expensive? I don't know. I can relate more with Naira. So so now $10 for the two, right? And then you go on and on like that. But now what I want to know in this case is this. I want to know the total shoe sales. So you see that some people bought shoes, right? So I want to know the total shoe sales in Africa. Now, this is a tricky one. Why is it tricky? When I say in Africa, I have here West Africa, right? I have here what? South Africa. I have here North Africa. I have here East Africa. I cannot hard code it and say in West Africa. One way you can do it, which is going to be very long, is to say I will do it for maybe West Africa plus, you know, North Africa plus, you know, East Africa. But just imagine you had like 20 Africa divided into like 20 segments. That may not be the best way to go. One thing that is common to all of them is that they all have what? Africa in them. So normally with wildcards, I would have easily been able to do it. But, you know, I can't do that with some products. So I'm just going to show you how to approach this. So what I want to get in this place here, just so that you know what our objective is, I want to know how many shoes, you know, total shoes, maybe if you say we are bought in what? Africa. So everybody that's Africa here that has something to do with Africa and is a shoe, I want to know the sales amount, the total. That's what I want to see in here. And these are the kind of questions bosses ask. They just come and just say, oh, okay, so how many of our clients reside in Africa? You need to find a way to give that answer, right? You can do filters to get this, but sometimes, you know, you get a little, it's quite a lot. And if, you know, you really don't have a good formula set up, it might also be a challenge for you. So sometimes it's also good to be able to use formulas. These are not the only ways you can do it. But again, I'm teaching some product here, and that's why I'm showing that. So first thing we're going to do is this. Let me introduce a function which can help us. There's a function called search. There's search function in Excel. There's find function. The two of them essentially do the same thing, but there's one, okay, no, there are two important differences, but let me talk about one. The one important difference is that one does a case-sensitive search while the other one doesn't do a case-sensitive search, okay? So that's really the difference. It means that capital A is the same as small a for find, but in search, they are different. But here, it doesn't really matter anyway, right? But you might want to pay attention to it also. So, okay, so now what I want to do is this. For me to know which cells will feature in my calculation or not, I want to do something externally here before I get into it. I can use the search function. Just follow me on this search function. The search function is asking me what text am I trying to find. I know I'm trying to find Africa. I put it in quotes. That's all I'm doing. Anything that has Africa, okay, put a comma. It says within which text. I want to check in this case within this. That's what I'm trying to do here is to search. In this text here where I have West Africa, is there Africa in it? If there is, what Excel is going to do is going to return the character where that Africa starts. Just watch it, you would understand it. When I press enter here, I get 6. What does 6 mean here? It means that at Africa, that A starts at character 6. Is that correct? West is 4 characters. There's a space. That's the 5th character, and A is the 6th one. Okay, so anywhere it sees Africa, it's going to return a number. Anywhere it doesn't see Africa, it's going to return an error because it cannot find what you are looking for. So take this down. Do you see what has happened? So you have places where you have numbers. You have places where you have what? Errors. Okay? So anywhere it's a number means that Africa is actually there. Anywhere where it's not a number means that you don't have Africa. So one way you can now turn this into like a true or false is to use another function called isNumber function. What is isNumber function? It's just a function that tests, is this a number or not? So it's that simple. Is this a number? Yes, it is. It tells you true. Is it a number? No, it tells you false. So what I'm going to do is, around this function, I will put an isNumber around it. Don't lose me, please. Just follow me. Or as they say, don't leave me, don't leave me. You know? So do you see what I'm just doing here is I'm using the isNumber to convert numbers to true, and it will convert anything that isn't a number to false. So let me take this down. Do you see what has happened? So now you see trues, and those trues are only on the rows where you have what? Africa. So this would be an interesting construct for me to use in my sum product. So this will help me to separate Africa from non-Africa just by using what? The isNumber function and search. Let me repeat this again, but verbally. You use the search function to find if the text is contained in the other text. If it gives you a number, it means it's there. If it doesn't give you a number, it means it's not there. But what I've just done is to put its number to convert it from, you know, number and error to true and false. Because it's easier to work with true and false than to work with numbers and errors. Do you understand? So this already, with this, you have already been able to separate, you know, the boys from the men. So you now see those that are African and those that are not African. So how do we get the total sales of what? Shoes now. So now this is, it's a little convoluted, but once you understand it, you understand it. So how many conditions do we have here? First of all, one, we have a condition on location. It must be what? In Africa. What's the second condition? The second condition is that it must be what? Shoes. So what we are looking for now is not just items that are in Africa, but items that are shoes and in what? Africa. And then we need to what? Sum up their what? Sales. So that's the question. So let me attempt to do this at the bottom here, just so that, is that a good place? Let me take this down a little, yeah. Okay, so let me do it here. So I'm going to use the multiplication construct, which I talked about in the last example. I'm not going to use comma. So the first thing is this. Let's do the easier one first. What's the first thing we know? That the product must be what? Shoes. So just take the product. This is what you do. Select the product from the first product, control shift down, and say, is it equals to what? Shoes. That's the first condition. You know what this would give you? This would give you true, false. Everybody should know that by now. Press F9 on this. Do you see? Well, that's what it is internally, yeah? Okay, now this is the first condition. Now, what's the next condition? The next condition is Africa, but maybe I leave that first and first multiply by sales because that one is very easy. I don't have any problem with this one. So let me just multiply it by sales first. Like I said, for some product, the order in which you multiply doesn't matter. Why? Because when you are multiplying two items together, it doesn't matter the order in which you multiply. A times B is B times A, at least on this side of the divide, right? So now, when I did control shift down, you notice he added the last cell there. If I don't take that cell out of it, I'm going to get an error automatically. Why? Because it means my arrays will not be of the same dimension, okay? So you notice everything stops. It starts from E3 to what? E22. This must also go from 3 to 22. So now, this is the second one. Now, let's go into the difficult one. The difficult one is testing the location. So what do we need to do for the location? We are going to use this construct we use here, the whole search and its number thing, to give us, you know, true, false, true, false. So let me do this. What I'm going to do is this. Let's hope this works. Wish me luck. I know people have been waiting for me to do an example that doesn't work. Let's see if today is that day. So let's do a search. So where are you? What are you searching for? You're searching for the text, what? Africa. And you're searching for it where? In this region. You know that that's where you're going to search for, right? You're not searching in location. It's in the region. Okay? Now you search for this. What is this going to give you? Let's evaluate it so everybody can see. I'm repeating what I did before, but now in a formula sense. You see that you have some numbers in there. You can see them. You have some numbers and you have errors in a lot of places. Okay? So we are getting exactly the same thing as we got before. Control Z. When you now put each number around it, each number will now help you to convert the numbers there to true, the value errors to what? False. So let's now test with the each number function. Okay? So I'm going to highlight from each number all the way. Do you see what has happened now? It has converted all those numbers 6 to true, for value errors to zero, to false was zero. So now that's pretty much it. So that's the last condition. All I now need to do is just to get my brackets correct. That should be everything. Now, why don't I need, you know, this is number here is giving me true, false, but I'm not going to do the minus, minus thing or one times or zero plus. Why? Because I'm already doing multiplications here. By the time I perform this multiplication operation on them, they will become numbers. So we should be fine with this. Let's see what the answer is. The answer gives me 134. So it says to me that in Africa, the number of shoes I have, as in the total sales, is 134. Let's see if that's correct. Let's do a filter. Come here. Filter, you can press Ctrl Shift L. Right? So let's filter. Let's do what we know. Product. We know that product should be what? Shoes. Put shoes here. So now we filter by shoes. Now let's filter on region by Africa. Right? That's what the question says. So what do we have? We have 120 and 14. When you add that together, what does it give you? 134. That's how you get the answer. So this is a very interesting example where, because you don't have Africa specifically written here, there's no cell here that has Africa as a word. So if you just search by Africa strictly, you won't get any answer. The answer will be zero because there's no cell there that's Africa strictly. But you're looking for cells that contain the word Africa. Okay? So, and that's where you use the search function. The search function will tell you if that text is contained first. Then what I just did with each number is to convert it from, you know, numbers and errors into true and false. And that's it. So that's the answer. Okay? 134. Take note of this. You can practice then, you know, after this this class. So I don't want you to get stuck on the examples. Think about this. This could be anything. So this could be a list of employees and their location and maybe their country or nationality, you know, or country of origin or something. And your supervisor says, and maybe on this side here, maybe this is their salary. And the supervisor asks a question like, I want to know the total salary for our employees, maybe who are from this region and maybe who were employed in so year. That's the question you are asked, but you should be able to translate that question into mathematical operations and, you know, into Excel and get an answer. Not a very simple example, but not a very difficult one also. So it's kind of easy, but takes some getting used to. Okay, so next one. Yeah, like, wow, that's something. Now, this is one I showed last week, and I want to do this now. This is called a two-way lookup. I can extend this into something very big, but let's start with this simple one. Now, let me explain the data. It's always important to understand it. It's just simple. I have different car manufacturers, right? And maybe I have, I don't know why I keep using sales, and I'm not a salesperson, but somehow it seems like the example everybody wants is money. Everybody understands. So, so I have the manufacturers here, and I have the months, okay? And what I want to just be able to do is to have a formula in such a way that when I select here a particular model, say Toyota, for example, and I select a month, it can tell me how much I sold in that month. What I've done here is just to do conditional formatting to kind of highlight the row that gives, you know, that is a match with what I've selected here, the column that is a match, and then the intersection I've put a conditional formatting to give me that. Conditional formatting is another subject I like so much, but that's a very deep one, and but we can't talk about that today. So what I'm doing here is I'm just changing manufacturers, I'm changing the month, and I want to be able to see in this cell, visually I can see it, yes, agreed. But if it's a very huge data set, you know, like a very large data set, you may not be able to see it this easy. I want to have a formula here that allows me to do this. Okay, so now, for those of us that are a little advanced in Excel, we know that we can do an index and match here. Everybody hears about this index and match. What is it really about? When you talk about the index function, what comes to mind is an intersection of like rows and columns. Okay, so once you have anything that has to do with I'm intersecting a row with a column, you should think of the index function, because what we are doing here essentially is if I choose Toyota, I'm taking this Toyota row, and if I say May I'm or March here, I'm intersecting it with what? March. That's really what I'm doing. So once you think about it and there's something like a row intersecting with a column, which obviously means a cell, you know, you should think of the index function. So this is a classic example for index and match. But I'm not teaching index and match. I'm trying to show you here that I can do it with some products. Okay? So this is another operation for some product. Now, this is one where you have to pay a lot of attention, because I'm going to say some things that will be very important. What I want to do in this example, so that everybody can see what's going on, is I'm going to move from Excel 2010, which I've been using, I'm going to go to Office 365 so that you can see what is happening internally and appreciate how the Sun product is working. So let me go to Office 365 and pull that example up. What example is that? That's two-way lookup, okay? Michael, just alert me if there are any questions, but I think people just want me to get through the examples. So now, so what are the conditions we have here? First of all, I want to check. The first thing is to check that what this car, the car manufacturer, is to check if it is equal to whatever the person has selected here. That's the first thing, right? So if I do that, let's do that here. For example, just to do a test, just say equals to this Office 365. It's going to act in some very funny ways, but please bear with me. Okay, but I would try and just make it. Let me do it exactly the way it should be done. Just follow. Okay, so select all the cars and test if they are equals to this. So what's this going to do? It's going to test everybody. Is Hyundai equals to BMW? That would be false. False, false, true. That's what it's going to give you. So do you see what it gives us? Can everybody see it? Do you see this? False, false, false. You see that where is true is where you have what? BMW. If you change this from BMW to, say, Toyota, you can see that your true becomes the second item, because that's where Toyota is. So this is the first thing, the first condition. Now, when you have this, you always have to think now, because some product, I mentioned that the dimensions must be the same. But when I say dimensions in this case, I don't mean that rows and columns must be the same. No, you just need to have one of them being the same. That's why I said you need to pay a lot of attention here. So now, first of all, I have this one. I've done this. At the end of the sum product, you need to multiply it by, of course, these sales in here, right, to get a number out of it. So what I'm going to do is this. I'm going to multiply these conditions here by these whole numbers. I want everybody to watch what this result is going to be. Watch this. The first thing I've done here is to test if the car is what I want. I will now multiply it by everything here. Just watch, everybody. Let me put them under where they should be. Do you see what has happened here? Because you are multiplying true, false by numbers. Anywhere there's false, because false in Excel is zero and true is one. Do you see what it has reduced this whole thing to? You see that everywhere that you had false here, they have become what? Zeros. The only row where you have numbers now is the row where you had a true here. So if I change this, for example, from Toyota to Mercedes, do you see what has happened? Because every other row is not a Mercedes, it is going to give me what? False. So once I have false and I multiply false by anything, it's zero multiplied by, it's all zero. So this is what you have internally. But we are not done. We've only treated the manufacturer, that the manufacturer is Mercedes. we've taken all the numbers we need. The last thing we need is to test that what the month is actually the what the right month. What is he going to do here? He's going to start looking at this month, January, February, March, April, May, June. Is it equals to May? So it means it's going to have false here, false, 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 true. So at the end of the day, when it does all of this, all those ones that are false would reduce to zero. So let me add the last condition in here so that all of us can see. When you multiply by the last condition, what's the last condition? Last condition is just to test that what this is equals to what me. Now, I want everybody to note something with my selections. Look at this, the manufacturers. How many rows do I have there? I have 7 rows, 1 column, 7 rows. When I multiply by the numbers themselves have what? 7 rows. That's why they can multiply themselves, even though you have multiple columns, but it works. But because I have 7 rows, 7 rows, that works. Now, why can I multiply it by this one here? The reason I can multiply it by this, the top here, is that January to June is 6 columns. And the numbers I have here also is 6 columns. So at the end of the day, that's what you need to think about. So long as you're having either the rows or the column dimensions as being same, you know, it can work. So what this is going to do now is that it has helped us to reduce, to put zeros wherever we don't have a Mercedes. Now it is also going to put zeros anywhere that the month is not May. So let me press enter so that you can see. Do you see what has happened? Everywhere that it's not May, so January is all zeros, February is all zeros, March is all zeros, April. So you can see that the only cell that we are left with is the cell that meets the criteria of what? Mercedes, and meets the criteria of what? Of May. Once you are done with this whole thing, just the way it is, this is the whole expression you need for your sum product. I will just put a sum product around it. And I just put, I need one bracket there. I need one bracket at the end. And I have my answer, 390. Whenever you change this to Toyota and change this to February. You see? 290, that's the answer. 290, 290. So this is a classic case for index and match, but you can do it with some product. But the reason it can work is because the dimensions, you know, are correct in the sense that if you have 7 rows, you should have 7 rows here. Even though you have multiple columns, it's fine. If you have 1 row here and 6 columns, you can multiply by multiple rows so long as you still have 6 columns. It takes some getting used to, but the moment you get it, well, as the Holy Book says, happy are ye. So that's the two-way lookup. I don't want to start sounding like a pastor. I admonish you to, you know, to go through these examples again. You know, like, don't say, I didn't get that. Yeah, you may not get it exactly, but if you can't listen to it more than 2 times and not get it, and if you do and you don't get it, please reach out to me gladly. I'll gladly, you know, even have a session with you and, you know, just walk you through it. So what we just did here is still using the sum product, but I decided to use Office 365 because it will show you what is happening, like the skeleton. So you start seeing how things start breaking down. Once you test a condition and it returns false, anything you multiply by false is zero, because false is zero. So it would nullify or take out those rows or those columns. And that's how you can get, you know, to what you want. This data could be anything. So even for an engineer, this could be maybe a list of wells and maybe their production in different months. It could be anything. For an HR person, it could be a list of employees and, you know, the hours they worked in, what's it called, for in those months. For a medical person, it could be a list of patients and maybe how many times they visited in those months. So my point here to you is that don't get stuck on, it can only work for sales. It can only work. No, it's an example. So what you need to do is understand the concept and you can apply it in whatever it is that you do. Okay, so that's that one. I will go back to my baby Excel now, which is Office 2010. So Michael, is there any question or any hands raised?
Okay, someone's hand went up, then it went down, so I'm confused. Okay.
The person received the answer, so they didn't need to. Okay. They didn't need to raise the hand.
I've been checking also the chat area. No questions.
Okay, it's really quiet today. Yeah.
Except if anybody has a question and is. You have a question right now you want to ask?
Yeah, if you have a question right now, at this point, before I go into the next example or like two examples, yes, you can ask the question now. So I'll gladly take that. Okay, somebody say no question, no. Who is that? Michele. That's okay now. I'm not even expecting a question from you. If you ask a question, I wouldn't answer it because it would be too difficult. Okay, so, but this is one example I like very well. So it's a two-way lookup. Okay, so now let's go into another example. And here it's going to get a little more interesting. Okay, now, so this is going to break us, you know, away from how we've always been thinking. So now, you notice that all the examples I've treated, I was dealing with like an and. I would say I'm looking for students that were born after 1993 and scored greater than 92. I'm looking for, you know, vehicles that are Mercedes vehicles and in this month. What happens when you want to do an or? Because some product by default does a multiplication. That's one thing, right? Because it says it multiplies corresponding items and it adds them together. So by default, it does an and multiplication. So there's already a challenge. But what if you want to do an or? So let's look at this data here. Can we look at this data together? Let me expand this a little. So it's similar to what we just did. The only thing I think I've taken out is the region. Okay, I don't have the region here. So still same data. I always like, you know, to explain the data so that you can follow. So now you have the names, their location, the products, you know, the prices, and you know, all of that. Okay. So now what I want to do in this example is I want to show you how to use an or in some products. Okay. So now listen to this question. Sometimes the problem is even more a problem of English than maths, or more a problem of English than even, you know, Excel. So if I'm saying, for example, I'm looking for total sales in Brussels, that's in Belgium, right? For shoes or combs. Now, let's think of something together. In each cell here, you can only have one item per time. There is no cell here where you have shoes, and at the same time in that cell, you have combs. Do you understand? There's no cell like that. Somebody saying it's not audible enough. Really?
Stranger, that is strange. I hear you very clearly.
Okay, okay. And I don't think anybody has said that. So I think the person may need to check maybe his speakers or something. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, okay. Somebody has said that can hear you clearly. I guess if I wasn't clear, somebody would have screamed from the beginning. Yeah. I don't think you would have let me go this far. Okay. So the person could try reconnecting, or maybe, yeah, someone said maybe connecting to another network. Okay, no problem. So good. So at least more people can hear me. That's fine. So now, you know, you realize that, so that we understand what I'm trying to do here. There's no cell here where you have shoes and combs at the same time. It's practically impossible, right? In a sense, because you have only one item per cell. So when I say I want to know total sales in Brussels for shoes or combs, right? It means that I cannot use an and, because no cell can be shoes and at the same time be what, combs. It's not possible. So what the person is really looking at is what? He's doing an or. So it's like saying it's in Brussels, it could be shoe, or it could be what, a comb. So when you have an or condition, how do you handle it in, you know, in some products? Because some product by default does an and, which is a multiplication. So that's what I want to do in this example. So let's take what we know. So first of all, let's do a sum product. Let me come to the bottom. I apologize. I'm not doing it in the cells where I intended to, but it doesn't really matter. Okay, so now let's do the sum product. I hope everybody got the problem here. What I want to do is I want to get the number of the total sales in Brussels for shoes or combs, not shoes and combs, because you can't have shoes and combs as a cell. So it's shoes or combs. So first thing is pull up your sum product. What's the first condition you know? Put a bracket. Let's put the first condition. The first condition is that the location is what? Brussels. Okay? So select your location and test if it's equal to Brussels. This is going to give you true, false, true, false, true, false. Okay? Everybody knows that already. Now, the next condition is where we go into the shoes or combs. But let's leave that first because that's the difficult part. The next part is that at the end of the day, you want to know the total sales, right? So you still need to multiply it by the sales. That's clear. So let's multiply it by the sales already. Then I will now go and do the last condition because that's where I have a headache. Okay? So these two would have taken care of cases where, you know, it's Brussels and what? As in, where is Brussels and it's sales. So let me do F9 on this so that we can appreciate what's going on here. Do you see what's happening? You have zeros in some places and you have numbers in some places. So anywhere it is not Brussels, it's automatically a zero already. Okay, because once you test and say equals to Brussels, if it's not Brussels, it's false. By the time false multiplies the number is zero. So the numbers you're having here are the places where you have Brussels. But that's the first one. You now need to include the last condition. The last condition is that what? It's shoes or combs. Now, so let me multiply. Let's assume I just go ahead and do times shoes. So I check if my product is equals to shoes. Okay, this is shoes here. Now, if I multiply by the last one and say equals to combs, my answer is already zero. Why? Because there's no row where you have what? There's no row or cell here where you have shoes and combs in the same cell. So it's never going to work. So the way you do an or condition in some products is to do a plus sign rather than a multiplication sign. So just note this. In Excel, when you are doing an and this, you use a multiplication sign. When you are doing an or, you use a plus sign. So what I'm going to do is those two conditions of shoes or combs, I'm going to add them together. That's how you include both. Okay, so this, I'm going to put an external bracket around that. The first condition here I've tested is for what? Shoes. That's this one here. Then I now add it to the test of the condition of what? I test that this one is equals to what? Combs. Okay, now let me explain this. When you test internally here, this one will tell you if it's what? Shoes or combs. The first one is going to be shoes. So it's going to give you true, false, true, false, true, false. The next one is also going to give you true, false, true, false, true, false. You know that true and false are one and zero. By the time you add them together, you will come up with a bunch of what? Ones and zeros. You will never come up with two. Why? Because there's no cell where you have both shoe and comb at the same time. So it's either going to be just going to be one and zeros. Look at it. So all the cells where you have ones are cells that either have a shoe in there or a comb in there. And all the ones that are zeros are those that don't have either shoes or combs. Okay? So all I've done here is to show you how to use the or. That when you have an or condition, and you sometimes nobody's going to tell you this is an or. But from the question asked, you should be able to figure that this is an or. Because like I said, you can't say, if for example, you say, tell me how many. The person asking the question could use the word and. But you should know that it means an or. Like it says, tell me how many clients are in Lagos and Ibadan. Nobody can be in Lagos and Ibadan at the same time. Do you understand? Right? So it's really an or. It's like saying Lagos or Ibadan. So take those in Lagos, add them to those in Ibadan. Because you can't have anybody who, I mean, location-wise now, at this point, T, who is in Lagos and in Ibadan at the same time. So the question may not use the word specifically, but you should be able to interpret it and know that this is an or. So what I've done here is I put the first condition, which is for Brussels location. I multiply by the sales, and then I do an or. So it's either shoes or it's combs. So that's all that condition, and I then close the bracket. I have 100. Let's see if this is correct. So we'll do a filter to test. So let's test location. So location should be Brussels. Okay. And when you do Brussels, let's see shoes and combs. The answer should even be obvious to us already because this one is belts. So shoes and combs is 80 and 20, which gives you what? 100. So that's how, you know, you do an or, you know, criteria within a sum product. I have another example which I wouldn't treat, but it's still the same. This is where I now have, you know, two ors in the sense that I'm looking at Brussels and London. Nobody can be in Brussels and London, right? So it's like Brussels or London. So I want to check for those who are in either Brussels or London, who also, as in, bought or sold shoes or combs. So at the end of the day, what you will have in this case is on the location, well, if you guys want me to do it, I may do it. On the location, you will do an or for Brussels or London. For the product, you will do an or for what? Shoes or combs, which is like adding them together, and then you multiply that by the sales. So that will give you the total sales for those in Brussels or London and who bought shoes or combs. So that's the idea. So for you to break out of the and, which some product does by default, you use a plus sign. The plus sign allows you to do an or criteria. You could take a look at it again, okay? So let's look at it again. The first condition here is testing for the location, all right? C, column C is your location. We are testing if the location is equals to what? Brussels. That's the first thing. I decided to bring the sales next. Like I said, the order is not important because you are multiplying them. It doesn't really matter. A times B times C is C times B times A. Okay, so the next thing is to multiply by the sales. Then the last thing is here. You have to put all that as one condition. So you are testing, first of all, is it equals to shoes? That's the product. Or, which is plus, or is it equals to what? Combs. That is, that whole thing becomes one condition, which you then multiply by the rest. Some product is really, really powerful, but you really need to understand how the conditions work. It's not, okay, a very simple example, neither is it a very difficult one. Once you follow the concepts and, you know, pay attention to your syntax, you will definitely be fine. So this is, you know, this is using some products with the or, function, so to say, you know, like when you have an or as opposed to an and, because by default, some product does an and. Okay, so Michael, any comments, questions?
No questions.
I know we have 5 minutes.
That's the thing I wanted to just say that.
Yes, I was taking a look at it, yeah.
Okay,
if anybody has a question, you could post it in the chat, or you could just ask. I think, Michael, we allow you to unmute yourself and you can ask. Okay, so if there isn't, I'm just going to do, I think, one more example. Yeah, I'm going to do one more example and I'm going to call it a day. So I'm going to make the workbooks available to Michael, the workbooks. I think it's the same workbook, and I think I left all the examples in there in the first one I sent. So the workbook is available to you, and the PowerPoint slides, so that you can make reference to some salient points, you know, or some nuances of the sum product function. So I take it that if there are no questions, it means people understand, or maybe people have just resorted to, oh, we'll go watch it online. You know, so either one is fine. Okay, so that's the way we do the or. I'm not going to do the nor. The nor is just like the negative, you know, of or, you know. So it's just like using a not function. We have to access the workbook. Okay, Michael, yes. Okay, Michael is, I think, attending to that. Okay, thanks. Okay, so let me... I wouldn't say by popular demand, but I feel like I want to go back and do the EO month thing I did last week or 2 weeks ago, which I know was where, you know, things seemed to go. I wouldn't say no, things didn't go south, but that was where people were like, oh, now, Victor, I think you are now really overdoing it. So I want to go back, you know, I want to go back to that example for those who watched it, but I want to kind of break it out here so that everybody can see what's going on. You know, I think that's the last example I'm going to do. There's one other example I can do. Okay, it's something related to dates too. Yes, some based on some problems I typically used to face in some data I used to get, but just how to get around it. Okay, so let me take this example again. And why I like this example is that it allows me to explain some other functions. As much as the focus is on the sum product function, but, you know, you will never really use the sum product function alone. The more functions you know, the more functions you can nest with the sum product to get your result. So let me explain what's going on in this one. I'm going to try and break it down again. I feel I need to do justice to it. So this is something I used to get, but again, like I said, it used to be something more in the line of production, but many people may not be able to relate with that. So let's just go with sales. So what I have here is I have an average sales, you know, for different months, right? This is January, February, March, April, all the way that way, okay? And these are the averages. Like I said, so what I want to know, first of all, is I want to know maybe the total sales for this year, And I also want to know the average sales for the year. Like I said, what some people may do, and I demonstrated this 2 weeks ago using a pivot table, it's really a weighted average, right? For the yearly average. For the yearly total, it's really just a sum product. Okay, so now let's understand it clearly and why maybe a regular average may not work. It doesn't work because the months don't have equal days. So you can't just add it up and just multiply by a number. You know, it doesn't really work that way. The way this works is this. Because these are averages, for you to know, you know, the total sales for the month of January, you need to multiply the average sale for January by what? The number of days. Because an average is already a total divided by a count. So an average is the total sales in January divided by the number of days in January. So now you are working backwards. You have the average you want to get the total. So it means you need to multiply the average by the number of days. So that's really it. But let me break down what exactly we would do and say a few things. This is the last thing I would do, but it may take me a little time, but do bear with me. I think, Michael, that should be fine. So first thing you need to be able to do is you need to know the number of days in January. At least if you know that, then you can then do, you know, multiply by the average to get the total. So the easiest way I have found to know the number of days in any month is to use, first of all, two functions, the EO month function and the day function. The EO month means end of month, right? So EO month for a particular month just means the last day of that month. So let me show you an example here so you understand. EO month, select the month. When it says months here, what it's trying to do here is it wants to shift it by, if I'm starting in January and I say months is one, it means move 1 month from January and tell me the last day of that month, which will mean the last day of February. But if I say two, it means move 2 months from January, which is March, and tell me the last day of March. But if I say zero, it means stay in that same month and tell me the last day of that month. Okay? So now, do you see what's happened? The last day of January is 31st of January. If you take this down, you'd see that everybody gives you the last day of that month. Can everybody see it? This is the last day in February. So it's a simple function, EO month. The EO month is end of month. So it just tells you the last day. So you can see the last day for all these months. Now, this is the interesting thing. The number of days in a month is the same as the last day or the day of the last day. What am I trying to say? If I have 31st of January as the last day of January, it means January has 31 days. So once I can get the day of that last date, the day of that last date, that's the number of days in the month. Does it make sense? So it means that the day, if I take day, which is another function in Excel, the day of this month, you see what it gives me? It gives me 31, right? Because if you say day of January 2nd, it gives you 2 because that day is the second day. So once you can get the last day of the month and you find the day of that, you know, you have what you need. Okay. So these are the number of days in those months. So once you have the number of days, this now is just a classic sum product. Why? You are multiplying the what? The average by the number of days. Average by the number of days. Average by the number of days. And adding everything together. That's a sum product, right? Because it's a product and then a sum. So it means you can easily do it now by just doing what? Sum product. You take what? The average first. And then you take what? The number of days. You see that? And this tells you the, what's it called? The total for the year. The average is simple. You can just take the total and divide it by what? The sum of these days. Huh? Just the average. Did everybody get that? So all we've just done is we've taken the EO month. EO month tells us the last day. When you take the day of EO month, that tells you the number of days in that month, right? First of all. And once you now do that, you can then do your sum product. But this is me doing it with help ourselves. What I would want to do, first of all, is to do it in one cell, right? Which is kind of how I typically work. I'm not saying that's the best way, but that's how I learned to build complex formulas. We're trying to do it in one cell. But I can always break it down because I know what goes into it. So once you can break it down this way, you can also build it up. But there will be a problem. And I said that in the last lesson. Someone is like, Victor, why did you choose to go to this EO month? Well, I think it's just something that's been haunting me, so I want to get it behind me. So what I should do normally is this. I should take some product. Let me get rid of all this. I think everybody understands it in its basic form now. So now let's come here. I'm going to take some product. I'm supposed to take the averages first. The next thing is I'm going to build that expression I just built there. What did I do? I first took EO month. And I selected all the dates. That's what I selected a date and I'm supposed to do comma zero. This is supposed to give me the end of month of all these dates. That's what it's supposed to give me, first of all. But you see, it gives me an hash value error. And I said this in the last lesson, and those of us who watch will remember that I did, you know, that EO month does not work in an array sense, in the sense that EO month can only take one date at a time. So once you are giving EO month multiple dates, EO month, you know, it's going to choke. So normally I should have been able to do this I just put a day around it, you know, to get the same 31.29 that I got before. That's what it's supposed to be. I'm just doing the same thing I did before. You know, this would have given me the months, you know, the days in those months, 30, 31, 29, and so on. Multiply by the average, and it's simple. And we're supposed to get the answer. But this doesn't work. So I then have to do something else. And why I'm emphasizing this is so that, would you please take this part again, if that is okay? Now, I'm not sure which part to do. do you mean the part of, if you, okay, well, you could speak or I could just ask. Do you mean the part of the day and the EO month? If that's the part you mean, then just put a yes so that I know and I just take it again. They never keep to the time. I don't know why.
Yes, that was when he typed that in.
Oh, that's when he typed that. Okay, all right. Yeah. Let me do that part again. So simple. So what I was saying is that for you to get the total sales, you just need to know the number of days in the month. Multiply the number of days by the average. That's it. You're right. If my average for a month is 10 and I have 30 days in that month, it means my total is actually 30 times 10, 300. Yeah, that's it. Okay, so what I've done here is, first of all, I'm trying to, my objective really is to get the number of days in the month. That's my objective. But the trick to getting it is, if you get the last day of the month, right, if you can get the last day of the month, the day, that day, whatever that day is the number of days in the month. What I mean is that the last day of February is 29th of February. The reason why it is 29th of February is because it's day 29. And it means that February has, what, 29 days, right? So that's really what I'm saying. So what I do is I will do EO month, okay? So I select the date and I put comma zero to say, find what? The last day of that month, the end of this month, the current month I'm in, okay? So when I do that, you can see this date. Everybody knows that the last date of January is 31st of January. Take that down. And what do we have? We have everybody's last date for all those months. Now, once I know this is the date, I can now use the day function. The day tells me what day is this. So all I'm trying to do, my objective is really to get the number of days in the month. But I'm using a trick, which is if I get the last day of that month, and the last day is 25. If I find that day, day 25, it means that that's 25 days in that month. That's just the idea. So here, I just do what day? I do the day of that date. Okay? So once I do day of that date,
okay, can anybody hear me? I don't know if it's at my end or at his end.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh, okay, so it's not my
end. Can't hear Victor.
Okay, I was already.
Victor is frozen.
Internet. I didn't know it was on my end. Okay, so maybe we just give him some few seconds to reconnect. Yeah,
apparently, network could have logged him out.
Must restart my internet.
Yeah. He has even messaged me.
So okay. Yeah, hello.
Yes, you are back.
Yeah, welcome back.
Oh, okay. Yes, it's coming back up. Yes, I mean, maybe it's a way of it trying to tell me that I need to close, but I'm not going to listen to it. Can you still hear me, Michael?
Yes, yes.
Okay, I think this is probably a slightly slower network, but... Let me see what happens if it comes back up. Okay, let me try and share my screen. Oh, my screen is showing. Okay, sorry.
No, it was. It's no longer showing.
It's no longer showing.
It's no longer showing.
Okay, just hold on. Sorry. This thing can be a little funny. Share content. Just hold on. Okay, let me see if this guy is back up. I don't want to call the name of the provider that just did that. That will not be good. That will not be good marketing for them. So let me just keep quiet.
They are all the same, Vic. Don't worry.
Okay. All right. So it should be back up now, I think.
Yeah, we can see the sheet.
Everybody, can everybody hear me now? Okay, all right. Yeah. So, well, I think in Nigeria, you probably don't need to apologize for that. Everybody kind of
We've seen the provider.
Okay, so I was just saying that. Oh, you've seen the provider. Okay, that's good. Yeah. So you can help me follow up with them and ask them why they did that to me. Okay, so yeah, so essentially what I was just trying to say is that when you do you get the number of months, right? So once you've done this, you can just do a raw sum product here. Your raw sum product is really just a case of what? Multiplying your averages, right, by what? The number of days. That's really it. So what I just did with the day and the EO month is just to get the number of days in that month. Like I said, just follow the concept. The concept here is that the last day of the month, whatever that last day of the month is, if you can find that day, if I say, oh, last day of this month is 35th of February. So it means that February has 35 days. So once you can get the day of that last date, that's the number of days in the month. That's the important thing you just need to note. Okay, and you press this and you know you have what you need. So once you get this, you can divide this by the number of days and you get the average. I was demonstrating that, right? And I want to show you something else. And I don't know why the network chose this time, but I am adamant, I am going to do it. So if it goes off again, I would use the hotspot for my phone. If that goes off, I'm going to steal someone's phone. No, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to get somebody's phone. So, but I'm saying that I'm going to do this whichever way. This is the last thing I'm going to do. Okay, so normally what we've just done now, that construct we've just come up with can easily work. I mean, that's what we are supposed to just build in the sum product. For those of us who remember the example on search and its number today, you realize that that's what we did. I first built it in the cells. You know, showed you how it worked, did the search function, did its number, then I wrapped it together back in the sum product. But because EO month can only take one date, you cannot give it a number of dates, you know, as in it never works. I've tried it even in Office 365, it doesn't still work. There are some stubborn functions like that, you know. So because of that, you can't go the EO month route. So you have to go a tricky route, okay? So now, this is something I like to explain just so that it's clear. I think I will be done with this in a few minutes. That Excel allows you to do day zero, which, like I was saying 2 weeks ago, and I think I'm correct, you know, that this doesn't work in maybe something like that. Just, I'm not trying to pick on DAX, right? I'm not a DAX guy. Someone's like, oh, they don't believe me, but I'm not a DAX guy. But, you know, DAX would say the dates have to be from 1 to 31. Okay, but Excel allows you to do day zero. But we all know that zero, the zeroth day does not make sense. So I am going to play a trick on Excel to get this function to work the way I want. Now, what do I mean by day zero? If I say the zeroth day, what's the first day of February? The first day of February is February 1st. Okay, so if I say zero day of February, what is that supposed to be? That's supposed to be the day before the 1st of February. But there's no day zero. So what's the day before the 1st of February? Is the last. Does it make sense? So the last day of January is technically 0 February. The last day of January is 0 February. So let me type in Excel. So watch me and so that you understand this concept. So sometimes you can play around with it in this way if you understand it. 0 February 2021. Look at this. Oops, it doesn't work. Huh? So let's put it in the date function. Date, the year, put 2021. Month, let's put February, which is 2. Day, let's put 0. You see what it did? It converted that 0th February to what? 31st of January. Let me show you another one so that you understand it clearly. Let's do December. Let's do 0 December. What does everybody expect that to be? 0 December is going to be the same as what? 30th of November. So do date, 2021. Month, let's do 12, which is December. Day, let's do 0. Do you see? I don't like this formatting anyway. Sorry. Yeah. This one doesn't have any ambiguity. Even though I know when I see 30/11 or 11/30, I know what it is, but I don't like the ambiguity. So this is how I like to have my dates. Okay, so what I'm going to do here in this case is this. As in, since my EO month, you know, I'm just going to play a trick so that I can use the zeroth day, because I know that the zeroth day of the next month is technically what? The last day of the previous month. I don't forget those number of days. So I will leave this number of days on the screen so that we can watch what I'm doing. You know, I would use a trick of using the zeroth day of the next month. The zeroth day of February would tell me 31st of January. And once I say day of 31st of January, I get 31, which is what I need. When I demonstrate, you will see it. So now, let me do this for everybody to see. Take your date function. For my year, we know that it's all in 2020 in this case, let's say. Let me just do that. For the month, so let me see what I will do for the month. Let me just do this here. Let me take the month of these dates. You know what this is going to give me, right? The month of these dates will give me what? 1, 2, 3 to 12. Does everybody agree with me? I can hear a silent yes. So these are the months of all these months here, all these dates here. Those are their months, 1 to 12. Now, what I'm going to do lastly is I'm going to put a zero as the day. But no, this is not going to be correct. What I want to do is I want to use the zeroth day of the next month so that it can give me the last day of the month I'm interested in. So it means that at this point, I need to add a plus one to this month, okay? And do comma zero. So for January now, it's going to, for January, it's going to move January to become what, the second month, which is February. It's going to do zeroth of February, which is going to give me what, 31st of January. So once I have it, this get the last days of all the months interested in. Let's see what this will evaluate to. It might not make sense when we look at it this way, right? Because it's not going to give you the dates. It's going to give you the numbers, right? But now when you put a day around it, because these are dates, by the time you put it around, it's what you need. Let me put F9 here for everybody. Look at these numbers here. These numbers are exactly what you need. 31, 29, 31, 30, do you see? So what am I doing? Because EO month doesn't work, I'm using the trick of, say, if I'm in January, move me by 1 month to February. But use the zeroth day of February, because I know the zeroth day of February is the what, last day of January, which is 31st of January. And if I find the day of 31st of January is 31, and that's the number of days. So this is what I'm going to use in my sum product, because I've gotten my number of days, right? So I'm going to do a sum product. You know, I'm multiplying the days by the average. That's all I'm doing. That's all I want to do. So I have my days now, and I multiply this by the average. I hope I did a better job with this today. I hope so. And I have the same answer. That's really what I wanted to do. The idea here is to don't the zeroth day of any month. That's all I'm doing here. So because I'm trying to look for what the January, what I did is to shift the month of January by 1 day. Okay, so by 1 month. I shifted the month by one rather. So I would do like dates. Let's assume this is 2020, hard code it. Then the month, let's assume that the month of January, which is one, we know it's one. I'll do 1 plus 1, meaning I'm shifting into February. But instead of picking 1st of February, I pick 0 of February. That 0 of February obviously is going to be what? 31st of January. Do you see? Okay. And once you do 31st of January and you put a day around this and say, what day is this? This day gives you what? 31. And that way, sorry, if you change the formatting, control shift tilde, you have 31 and you have what you want. So this is just to teach you something else so that sometimes, you know, dates are very interesting and I really like them because you can manipulate them in a lot of ways, you know. So with this, at least you learn, you know, something about the day function, what the EO month tells you, the end of the month, EO month tells you the last day of that month, right? Then you can use the date function. The date function just uses a year, a month, and a day, and it gives you the date to get a lot of interesting things. So I just wanted to maybe try and, I wouldn't say redeem myself, but, you know, just break it down a little more and hopefully maybe explain it better this time. I hope I did. And that's it. And that's it. And yeah, this way I want to now ask myself. So Michael.
Thanks a lot for, again, another wonderful session. I think some people really like you. You know, they want to put you on a recursive loop, like, explain it again,
But you said you want to put me on what? Sorry, I lost you.
I say some people want you to keep explaining it, like they want to create what we call like you know, you explain it, they say explain it again, and then someone else explain it again, and it never ends. Unfortunately, we have to stop here, but there's a way can always get him explaining it again, is by you watching the recording. So that's a more resource efficient way of explaining it again.
Absolutely.
It's been a wonderful one. Thank you very much. And to all our audience, you know, all the participants today, thanks for joining and staying to the end. And so, as I've mentioned, the recording will be available hopefully tomorrow, because I'm not the only one involved in it, and I hope to let you be able to get it on time. But even if you don't get an email from me or from anybody by tomorrow, let me give you the link of where you can always go pick the recording. There's a YouTube link that always have all the recordings. So that's is a DIY way of you getting the recording.
It's my network, but I seem to be losing.
Okay. The recording will be on. Yeah. Great. So it will be on that place, hopefully by tomorrow night. Okay. Let me also grab you, Victor Momo's YouTube. Are you able to help us post your YouTube channel? Okay, great. Let me even grab the direct link. So with that, I think we can end.
Yeah, right.
Let me get the direct link. Good. So I've gotten the direct link. Okay. So I'm pasting the link of Victor's YouTube channel, where you get more of these goodies around formula breakdown and all. Okay, so at this juncture, we have to call it a close, you know. Thank you very much once again, everybody. And Sir Victor, awesome work. Thanks for always honoring our invitation.
Always a pleasure. Always a pleasure.
I think the next one is index now. It's just to give us dates.
I think you already fixed the date, right?
I'll go check then. I'll go and check. So thank you very much.
Yeah.
And bye, everybody. Have a nice week ahead. For those interested, Power BI will be a replay by. There will be Power BI by 6 p.m. Let me just paste the link for you. Then I hand the link. Where is that link again? If it's looking proving too difficult to paste, I can always paste it after the session anyway. So let me let you go to rest. So bye. Thank you very much. Have a nice.
Thank you, Michael.